Hello everyone. So this is once again Dr. Khalid Imran. So this is your second lecture on module 5, that is part 1, machine tools. So in the previous class we had discussed what exactly is a machine tool, different types of machine tools. We had seen what is a center lathe, which is as shown in the figure. We had seen different parts of a lathe, which is a machine tool. Like headstock, tailstock, then you have the carriage assembly, then we had the lead screw. So I had explained all the parts of it. In fact, you had seen a video also the working of the center lathe, this video.
This machine is known as center lathe for making.
Yes.
It is used for
you had seen this video earlier. So we shall continue with the remaining part of the module. That is machine tools. So the figure which is shown here in the slide is of a single point cutting tool. So as I had explained earlier that every machine tool can either have a single point cutting tool or a multi-point cutting tool. Like basically in a lathe we have single point cutting tool, and this is the figure of the single point cutting tool. The material which is used to make this tool is high speed steel, HSS tool steel or high speed steel. And this has a single cutting edge here. You can see the end cutting edge. This has various surfaces. You can see like, you know, it has a base, it has a shank. The entire part is a shank which is held in the tool holder. Then you have the base. Then we have the side cutting edge. You have the end cutting edge. You have nose, you have flank. See, this particular topic about single point cutting tool is not there in your syllabus. I just wanted to show you how exactly a cutting tool looks like. Now this is a single point cutting tool having a single cutting edge. On the other hand, there are different types of other cutting tools, like multi-point cutting tools, like you have a milling cutter. Then we do have a drill bit. A drill bit is a cutting tool which is held in a drilling machine, be it a portable drilling machine or a sensitive drilling machine or a radial drilling machine. In these machine tools, the type of cutting tools used is a drill bit, which is a multi-point cutting tool. Not just on drilling machine, the drill bit can also be held where in a lathe. So that is the reason I had told you earlier that lathe is considered to be the mother of all machine tools. As operations which are carried out on a drilling machine, on a grinding machine, can also be carried out where on a lathe. So besides, the very objective of the lathe is what? To produce circular objects, to produce conical objects. So besides producing the conical and the circular objects, it can also drill, it can also tap, like in make threads inside a hole, it can finish a hole, it can do many other operations which can also be carried out on other machine tools. So the name is what? Mother of all machine tools. So I wanted to show how exactly a single point cutting tool looks like. So this tool is held in the tool post. The tool post which is, you can see the tool post here. This is the tool post. Here in this two-way tool post or a four-way tool post, we basically hold the cutting tool, that single point cutting tool. And multi-point cutting tools are held in your tailstock. In this particular section, we can remove the dead center, and in place of the dead center, one can accommodate a multi-point cutting tool like a tap or a drill bit or a countersink tool, so on and so forth. So the next topic is about the operations on a lathe. There are a host of operations, a variety of operations which can be conveniently carried out on a lathe, like a turning operation. Turning operation is the most fundamental operation of a lathe. So when you turn a particular object or a particular specimen or a component, we get a circular part. So once again, under turning, there is plane turning, there is step turning, there is shouldering operation, there is parting operation, the separation operation. So there are a variety of operations under turning itself. So followed by, like, you know, facing operation, then we have thread cutting operation, taper turning operation, knurling operation. The number 7 is what? Your parting operation, chamfering operation. These operations like turning, facing, thread cutting, taper turning, knurling, then we have parting operation, chamfering operation, providing a radius. All these operations are the most fundamental operations on a lathe which can be conveniently performed. On the other hand, the operations such as drilling operation, tapping operation, boring operation, reaming operation, milling operation, and grinding operation are auxiliary operations. These operations can also be performed on a drilling machine, like drilling operation can be performed on a drilling machine. Then we have tapping operation, that is generating a threaded hole, can also be performed on a drilling machine. Boring operation can be performed on a boring machine using a boring tool. And then we have reaming operation, which can be performed on a drilling machine. Milling operations can be performed on the milling machines. Similarly, grinding operations can also be performed on the grinding machines. So what I mean to say here is the operations such as drilling, tapping, boring, reaming, milling operations, which can be performed on their respective machine tools, can also be performed on a lathe. So these are just a few operations which are highlighted in this slide, but still there are many operations which can be performed on a lathe. So the name is what? The mother of all machine tools. Coming to the very first operation, which is what? The turning operation, the most fundamental operation. What we see here is plane turning operation, not even step turning operation, it's just plane turning operation. Now this is the first operation, which is what? Plane turning operation. Here, if at all you witness this, if you watch this, this is your chuck, C-H-U-C-K, chuck. The name is not shown clearly here. It is a chuck here, and we have the workpiece. The workpiece is held inside the chuck. This particular chuck has what? The jaws. So this is a 3-jaw universal chuck, or it can also be a 4-jaw independent chuck. So the jaw made up of a material such as mild steel or cast steel, basically mild steel, is held where? In this chuck. How exactly it is held? You had seen in the previous video, in the working of the central lathe, like using a chuck key. Here you will be having a keyhole. So in that hole, when the chuck key is inserted and rotated, these three jaws, they move simultaneously, like, you know, they converge and they diverge. They come, like, you know, they come at the center and they go from the center outside. So by the movement of these jaws, the three jaws of the chuck, one can easily hold the workpiece in this fashion. Once the workpiece is held, you can see the axis of the lathe is coincident with the axis of the workpiece, right? It is coaxial. Now you have the tool. The tool is made up of high speed steel, or you can have a carbide tip tool. This tool is held in the tool holder, that is the tool post. And now you can see this, the adjoining figure here, the adjacent figure. This particular figure also shows the same. So this is the workpiece. This is the reduced diameter. You can see this in both the figures, the diameter is reduced. This is the raw material diameter. This is the new reduced diameter which we have obtained. Assume that the diameter is somewhere around 80 millimeters. I want 60 millimeters. So 20 millimeters material, which is not wanted, which is an unwanted material, is cut in form of filings. You can see iron ribbons, iron curlings. They fall down inside the tray of the lathe. So if you happen to see this particular figure, this is a tray. In this tray, what is falling down? What is falling down? The uncut material, the cut material, the material which is removed from the workpiece, unwanted material, falls down in form of small curlings or filings or ribbon or ribbons. Okay. So here, the tool is held in the tool post. So, like, you know, there are different parameters. I told you yesterday, I told you in the previous class, like, there are three important parameters. One is the cutting speed of the tool, one is the feed of the tool, and one is the depth of cut of the tool. So when you speak of the feed is so many millimeters per revolution. How many millimeters of material is being removed per revolution of the workpiece is nothing but your feed. So the feed, the speed, can be altered, can be varied using the gearbox which is put up in the headstock of the lathe. You know what is the headstock of the lathe, which we had discussed in the previous class. So then we have the depth of cut, one more important parameter, which can be given in terms of microns or so many millimeters. So when the tool moves perpendicular to the axis of the lathe or axis of the workpiece, we are giving certain amount of depth of cut. So depth of cut is given perpendicular to the axis of the lathe, so many millimeters, so many microns. Once the depth of cut is given, assume that here the depth of cut is given is, say, some, you know, 5 millimeters or 10 millimeters. 10 millimeter depth of cut is not practically given. Just for the sake of simplicity, I'm explaining here. Like, you know, 10 millimeters depth of cut is given here. Like, assume that the tool to be outside here somewhere. Now when you give the depth of cut of 10 millimeters, it comes somewhere over here. You can see here. So the tool initial position is somewhere outside. When you give a depth of say 2 millimeters or 1 millimeter in this particular figure, you can see that the tool moves inside like this. Now when the feed is given in such a way that the tool has to move parallel to the axis of the lathe or the workpiece. Now this is the axis of the workpiece as well as lathe. The tool is moving from right hand side to left hand side. You can see that is feed, so many millimeters per revolution, and the unwanted material is removed so as to get the finished workpiece in this fashion. So you can see a new surface which is generated here. This is the previous diameter, this is the current diameter, this is the raw material diameter, this is the finished product or finished component diameter. I hope all of you have understood this. You can watch this video.
In straight turning, the tool is fed parallel to the axis of the work to reduce its diameter so that the final diameter is the same at each end. Removing a significant amount of material in one pass is called rough turning. The final lighter cut that creates a smooth surface finish is called finish turning. Taper turning produces a taper along the axis of the workpiece. Tapers are produced by offsetting the tailstock from centerline or by using a taper attachment. In straight turning, the tool is fed parallel to the axis of the work to reduce its diameter so that the final diameter is the same at each end. Removing a significant amount of material in one pass is called rough turning. The final lighter cut that creates a smooth surface finish is called finish turning. Taper turning produces a taper along the axis of the workpiece. Tapers are produced by offsetting the tailstock from centerline or by using a taper attachment. Short, steep tapers can be turned using a compound rest. Contour turning, or profiling, was formerly performed by having the single point cutting tool trace a template of the desired profile shape. This has largely been replaced by CNC turning, in which the desired contour is simply programmed into the machine, which directs a cutting tool to cut the contour. Forming is another alternative for generating complicated shapes. The tool, having the desired form or geometry, is advanced perpendicular to the axis of rotation, reproducing the tool shape in the workpiece. Forming is commonly performed on automatic screw machines.
So these are all different operations which are carried out.
Furring eliminates sharp corners from a workpiece and is a good safety measure. Typically, chamfering breaks corners at a 45 degree angle. Grooving creates a groove or recess using a tool that is usually the size and shape of the required groove. Some grooving tools can also widen a groove by traversing side to side after plunging into the workpiece.
So I hope all of you have got a very clear idea about what exactly is a turning operation. Besides turning, he has also shown many other operations like parting operation, grooving operation, chamfering operation and all, which is not part of your syllabus. But the video which was shown very clearly depicts the beauty of the mechanical engineering, especially your machine tools. Machine tools have gone very far, very far. It has progressed a lot, especially when the advent of computer numerical control machines, CNC machines, then we have the automation systems, the robotics, all these things together has paved a way to see that machine tools have flourished a lot. and anyone can produce any complex component by the help of this machine tools, right? The next operation is facing operation. Facing operations are basically carried out to have the flat surface at the end of the workpieces. So if you happen to see this figure, this is the workpiece from here to here, workpiece, and this workpiece is held in a chuck. It's a simple representation of facing operation. Then you have the facing tool here, but here the feed and the depth of cut are opposite when compared to your turning operation. In turning operation, when the workpiece is fed in the direct perpendicular to the direction of the axis, then that was known as depth of cut. But in case of facing, it is known as feed. Why? Because we are removing the material perpendicular to the axis of the lathe. You can see this axis of the lathe or axis of the workpiece, both are same here. So this facing tool, which is also a single point cutting tool, is held in the tool post. And when the wheel of the carriage is moved, what happens is we can remove the unwanted material from the end face of the workpiece. See, this is basically a workpiece. Whenever we take a round rod, for example, if the raw material is in shape of a rod, a circular rod, we need to ensure that the end surfaces, the lateral faces of the workpiece are flat. Both are flat. So to make them exactly flat, we need to perform an operation known as facing operation. In fact, once you get a flat surface, then we need to generate a hole here. In order to make a hole here, like the hole is named as a countersink hole. A countersink hole is one which is made using a countersink bit, right? In order to accomplish this particular task, this particular operation of countersinking, we need to have a flat surface here. The lateral faces of the cylindrical piece should be exactly flat, 90 degrees to this axis. Clear? That being the reason, we need to perform the facing operation. So facing operation is not just performed to get the flat surfaces, but even it is used to, you know, it is used for producing shouldering operation. Like, you know, shouldering operation is also performed using a facing tool. So but the fundamental operation here is to perform, is to get a flat surface at the lateral ends of the workpiece. So this is the workpiece here. And now when the tool is moving in a direction perpendicular to the axis of the lathe, the unwanted material is removed. Now there are two approaches for facing operation. Either the tool can be initially aligned at the periphery of the workpiece, means at the outer diameter of the workpiece. And we can make the tool to move from the outer end to the center, or the other way. The tool can be moved from the center to the outer surface. See, for there are two operations in facing, be it turning operation or facing operation, there are two things to be considered. One is, like, you know, there is no something known as rough turning and finish turning. So for rough turning, we can give more amount of depth of cut but lesser amount of feed, where in case of your rough turning. For finish turning operation, we will have to give less amount of depth of cut and more amount of feed can be also given. On the other hand, for facing operation is quite different here. In facing operation, the depth of cut is given. How exactly? It is given when the tool moves parallel to the axis. Depth of cut is given in this direction, parallel to the axis of the lathe or parallel to the axis of the workpiece. Say I want to remove material of 3 millimeters. You can see the difference here. Initially, the material of the workpiece was till this limit, till this particular edge. Now you can see the length of the workpiece is reduced from this surface to this surface. So somewhere around 2 to 3 millimeters of material is removed here in one go, right? So, like, you know, depth of cut is given by moving the facing tool parallel to the axis of the lathe. Once the desired depth of cut is achieved, one can lock the entire carriage at that particular position. See, carriage can be locked at any desired position on the lathe bed, right? So once the carriage is locked, then using the compound, using the, you know, the cross lathe. So this is the cross lathe. I'll just show in the figure. Yeah, this is the lathe. wherein you had seen this particular hand wheel. This hand wheel is what? The cross-laid hand wheel. When this cross-laid hand wheel is moved, then the cross-laid moves in a lateral direction, nothing but in a transverse direction. The movement of the rotation of the bigger wheel, the hand transversing wheel, when this is rotated, the entire carriage moves in a longitudinal direction. On the other hand, if the smaller wheel is rotated, this particular cross-laid moves in a transverse direction, nothing but perpendicular to the axis of the job or the lathe. So that way being, you can see here, facing operation. So in this facing operation, when the cross-laid is rotated, when the wheel of the cross-laid is rotated, the cross-laid moves. Thereby, we are giving a feed by rotating the cross-laid handle or cross-laid wheel, right? So the cross-laid is operated here so that the facing tool moves perpendicular to the direction of the lathe axis, thereby accomplishing the feed, and the unwanted material is comfortably removed. So as the tool further, you know, moves in the direction perpendicular to the axis of the lathe, the remaining amount of material also gets removed. Since it is, this component is symmetric and rotating, this material as well as this material is removed very conveniently for the given depth of cut, and depth of cut is accomplished by moving the tool parallel to the axis and locking the carriage. And when the cross laid is moved perpendicular to the axis of the lathe, then feed is accomplished. Because of the feed which is given, the unwanted material is removed, and what we get is a flat surface. Once we get a flat surface, a hole can be drilled here, a countersunk hole can be made, tapping up, operation can be performed, various other operations can be conveniently performed. I hope all of you have understood what exactly is facing operation. So things will be more clearer if at all you watch this video. Watch this video. So you can see here, like, you know, this is your workpiece, and the amount of unwanted material is removed by facing operation. This is the entire tool post, and this is the tool holder, at the end of which we have a tool, a single point cutting tool, wherein the facing operation is being performed. It's more clear now. So you can witness here, you can make the tool to move either from the center to the outer periphery of the workpiece, or from the outer periphery of the workpiece to the center of it. So in this facing operation, I told you two things. As we have seen that there are two operations, like rough turning and finish turning, there is also something known as rough facing and finish facing. For rough facing or for rough facing operation, the tool can either move from the outer periphery of the workpiece to the center, or it can also move from the center to the outer periphery. Whereas in the case of finish facing operation, the tool is made to move from the center to the outer periphery. That is the real difference here. Okay, that is the end of your facing operation. The next operation is your knurling operation. See, knurling basically is an operation which is carried out so as to provide a grip on handles, on levers. We find, levers in a drilling machine. We find, grippers rather. For example, if it's an automobile, if it's a two-wheeler, then basically we accelerate the entire vehicle by making a lever to operate. Like you have the handle, and when you accelerate it using your hand, like, you know, if you're using your hand in this fashion, what happens, you need to have a grip. If there is no grip, there are chances that the hand may slip over the gripper, or the hand may slip over the covering which is given in case of a vehicle. But in many places in machine tools, you will find many handles, like, you know, if it's a drilling machine or a machine tool or any other machine like a shaper or a milling machine, we find the handles. And if at all you want to move a handle very conveniently, comfortably, we need to have a grip. Means grip is nothing but producing of serrations of a rough surface over the part of a lever, so that handle, the handle or the levers can be comfortably gripped by the hand, and the person who is operating the handle ensures that there is no slip. That is the whole idea about knurling. So if at all, if you have seen a jack, a hydraulic jack, or not a hydraulic jack, but a mechanical jack, like what is a jack basically? Jack is it's assembly, it's a machine by the help of which you can lift loads. For example, if it is a huge automobile like a lorry or whatever, like a bus or a lorry, suppose you want to lift the lorry to a particular height, then we have a screw jack. In a screw jack, you'll be having a huge lever. That lever is inserted inside the jack and it is rotated. Since there is huge amount of inertia to be impounded, now you have this rod, nothing but we say as Tommy bar. The Tommy bar will be having, at the end of it, you'll be having a knurled surface. A knurled surface is nothing but you'll be having serrations, small diamond-like pattern or plain simple lines. So that is provided so that the person who is operating the jack or the person who is operating a lever in a machine can easily handle it without any slip. This is the application part of it. I hope you have understood this. So, you know, knurling is an operation to make serrations. Serrations, nothing but it is a pattern, a diamond-like pattern or crosswire pattern or just lines at a smaller portion of the rod, not the entire lever or the rod. This is a smaller portion, so that the person who is operating that particular machine by holding the levers can easily do it. That is the whole idea about knurling. So knurling is accomplished in a lathe. So that's one of the operations of lathe, is knurling operation. If you see this particular figure, once again, this is chuck. These are the jaws of the chuck. And in the chuck, the job is held, the workpiece is held. Now this is your cylindrical workpiece, which is held in the chuck by the help of these jaws. And now you have the knurling tool. A knurling tool is this one. The entire assembly is the knurling tool. The knurling tool is fixed inside the tool post. And at the end of the knurling tool, there will be set of rollers. You can see these are the rollers, which are hardened rollers made up of cast steel or any other special alloy. There'll be set of rollers here. Like, you know, these rollers, when pressed against the rotating workpiece, what happens? The pattern which is available on the rollers gets impregnated here. Means you get the serrations directly. Why? Because the material of the workpiece is mild, very soft when compared to the material of the tool. This is the tool material. So this is your tailstock center. So, like, you know, the workpiece is held between the headstock and the tailstock. One end of it is held in the chuck and the other end is supported by the tailstock center, dead center or live center. In fact, the tailstock is not shown here. So now, when this particular knurling tool, which is having hardened rollers, are pressed against the rotating workpiece, since the material of this being softer than the material of the tool, that is the rollers, you get a pattern here. Like, you know, if there are two rollers here, you get a diamond pattern. Sometimes you'll be having one single roller. That roller helps in having a straight serration. Serrations are nothing but a pattern which is obtained here. Clear? The speed of the knurling has to be very, very slow in comparison with your turning operation or facing operation. The speed of the workpiece is very less in comparison with the turning operation. Almost half of the speed of turning, right? Or sometimes it is only 30% of the speed of the turning operation is achieved here. With respect to that speed, this particular knurling operation is performed. I hope you have understood this. What is the application of knurling operation and how exactly knurling operation takes place? So you will get to know about knurling operation in detail when you watch this video. Yeah, just watch this video. And this is a knurling tool. Knurling tool, this is the workpiece. These are the rollers, hardened rollers. Knurling tool having rollers at the end of it. You can see a set of rollers here. This is the chuck. And this is the workpiece held inside the chuck by the help of this. This is a 4-jaw independent chuck. It's not the 3-jaw chuck, it's a 4-jaw independent chuck. This is the tool post. This is the compound slide. This is the cross slide. This is the cross slide, this is the compound slide. Just watch the video carefully. You can watch this. There is a pattern here, a diamond pattern. So this diamond pattern is dependent upon the pattern which is available on these rollers. Okay, there will be lines at an angle of 45 degrees on one roller. One more roller will be having lines in the opposite direction. When these two rollers are pressed against this rotating workpiece, what we get is a diamond pattern like this. Yes. Yeah. Next operation is your thread cutting operation. Thread cutting is basically what? Generation of a helical ridge. I hope all of you have seen your bolts and nuts, studs, bolts, nuts, screws and all. What are these basically? These are fasteners, temporary fasteners. See, whenever we speak about fastening is basically joining two metal plates or two pieces made up of any material. Now, when we join two pieces together, either they can be joined permanently or they can be joined temporarily. Permanent joining methods are your riveting method, then we have your welding method, right? Or we have brazing method, soldering, welding, brazing, all these things are permanent joining methods. On the other hand, temporary joining can be accomplished by means of bolts and nuts. So when we see a bolt and nut, I am very sure that all of you must have seen how exactly a bolt looks like, how exactly a nut looks like. In your lifetime, you must have seen what is a thread, like, you know, what is a screw. Now, if you happen to, you know, witness the helical ridge over the bolt, that helical ridge is nothing but the thread. Technically, we call that as threads. So here in this particular figure, you can watch, these are the threads. Right, so these bolts and nuts are used as temporary fasteners. Screws are used as temporary joiners or fasteners. Suppose I want to join two plates of metal. We can make a hole in these two plates, insert a bolt and screw a nut over the bolt by help of a washer so that it has a tight assembly as such. So, like, you know, whenever one needs to make this helical grooves or the helical ridges on a cylindrical piece or on a conical surface, then that operation is known as thread cutting operation. So there are different types of threads. There can be V thread. This is the figure which you are seeing here is what? It's a V thread. It can be a V thread. It can be a square thread. It can be a trapezoidal thread. The geometry of the thread also varies depending upon the geometry of the tool. And once again, we have a variety of threads like BSW thread, Whitworth thread and all. Let us not delve into all those aspects. We are only concerned with the thread cutting operation. The type of thread which is visible to you is a V thread here. You can see the pattern, you can see the geometry of the thread is V. So the angle between these two flanks of the thread, these are known as the flanks of the threads. The angle between this is 60 degrees. For a V thread, the angle is basically 60 degrees. So here also the external angle is 60 degrees. The tool is made up of high-speed steel. And this tool is held where? In the tool post as usual. So after holding the tool in the tool post very securely, very rigidly, the workpiece is held where? Between the centers. So these are the centers. One center is fixed inside the chuck or in the spindle of the headstock. Here what part comes? The headstock. On the right hand side, what part comes? The tailstock. Or it can be vice versa also. But here, assuming that this particular center is held in the spindle of the headstock, and this particular center, so this can be a live center or a dead center. A live center is one which rotates along with the workpiece, and a dead center is one which does not rotate along with the workpiece. So these two centers are held in the headstock and tailstock, and the component or the workpiece, the raw material, is gripped between these two centers. Once the axis of the workpiece is aligned with the axis of the lathe, now we have the tool. This tool is nothing but the thread cutting tool. The thread cutting operation is carried out by the help of the carriage and the lead screw. So you have seen the carriage assembly in a lathe, right? So like, you know, if at all one wants to move the carriage automatically without any human intervention, then there is something known as lead screw. So in the previous class, I had shown you what exactly is a lead screw. If you see this particular figure here, this is the carriage assembly. The entire thing is the carriage assembly. We know that this is your cross slide. This is your compound slide, right? By the help of compound slide, the compound slide will move in a linear direction. When this handle, you have a small wheel. When this wheel is rotated, the compound slide moves. On the other hand, you have the, I had told you about the cross slide. The cross slide will move perpendicular to the axis of the lathe. And this particular bigger hand wheel, which is hand traversing wheel, when rotated, the entire carriage assembly moves in a linear direction. That is a manual operation. On the other hand, there is something known as lead screw, which is a power screw, which I had explained earlier also. So this lead screw, when engaged with the carriage assembly, so here inside you will be having a nut. A nut will be having what? The helical threads inside. Nothing but helical ridges rather. So the nut, when assembled or when synchronized with the lead screw, so this lead screw acts as a bolt, and this nut inside is nothing but a functional nut. So when the assembly of this lead screw and the nut inside is accomplished, and now when the lead screw is given rotary motion, this starts rotating. The lead screw starts rotating. When the lead screw starts rotating, as the nut is in synchronization with the lead screw, what happens? The entire carriage assembly moves automatically from left hand side or right hand, left hand side to right hand side, or right hand side to left hand side. So the single point cutting tool, nothing but your thread cutting tool, is fixed here in the tool post. And when the machine is on, when the chuck is rotating with the workpiece held inside, what happens? You are getting the threads in this pattern. The speed here is very, very less. 50% of the speed of the turning operation, or sometimes even 20% of the speed of the turning operation. And this particular tool is moving from right hand side to left hand side. So like, you know, the thread cutting operation is accomplished not in one single pass, but here feed is given, the depth of cut is given, like, you know, in steps, in incremental steps. Initially, like, you know, 1 millimeter depth of cut is given, then 2 millimeters, then 3 millimeters. It all depends upon the type of material which is being machined here. If the material is very, very hard, then the depth of cut given is very lesser. Otherwise, more depth of cut can also be given. So when this particular tool moves automatically, how is the automatic movement accomplished? By engaging the carriage with the lead screw. When the carriage is, you know, engaged with the lead screw, automatically this particular tool moves with a uniform speed or uniform velocity. This particular tool moves. Every time the desired length is accomplished, the tool is taken back. Once again, more depth of cut is given, and once again the operation is carried out. So, like, you know, in one or two or three or four trials, the entire helical ridges are obtained. Nothing but the thread cutting operation is accomplished. I hope all of you have understood what exactly is thread cutting operation. You can witness the video now. Guys, grinding the tool. There's a grinding machine, grinding wheel. It's a protractor. He's setting up different types of angles, like rake angles, leaf angles, and all. It's a V thread. It's a V tool, thread cutting tool. So you can witness the single point cutting tool. So it is aligned with the center of the lathe, with the lathe axis. This is your piecing operation. This is your drilling operation. Sorry, countersinking operation. Yeah. So basically, countersinking operation is carried out so as to grip the workpiece in the tailstock. Yeah, this is the center. This is the tailstock. You can see the center. Center is going where? This is dead center, which is going inside this particular workpiece. You can see the workpiece. How exactly it is going inside? We had, you know, made a small hole. That small hole is known as countersink hole. So the, you know, one end of the workpiece is supported by the center, which is held in the tailstock. The other end is held in the chuck. Turning operation carried out. Rough turning operation. So it is being marked till what point should be the operation carried out. Yeah. Now you can witness it. It's a V thread having an angle of 60 degrees. It's a gauge. Yeah, you can see the helical ridges formed in the first level, or you can say in step one. That is a pitch gauge. The pitch has to 1.5 millimeters. The second run. So in several stages, the depth of cut is increased and the thread cutting is accomplished. Since so many passes, it takes many passes so that ultimately you can see the tool cutting. It's been fast forwarded. So ultimately, what do you get? You get a perfect V thread. You can see the material being removed in form of curlings, in ribbons, in chips. Now that is a nut and that is a V thread, which is successfully obtained, machined. Yes. that's a gauge once again. So this is all about your thread cutting operation. Right. So this is the end of today's class. We have discussed many operations like thread cutting operation, knurling operation, followed by facing operation, then turning operation. So we have discussed four operations. We are left out with other operations such as taper turning operation, drilling operation, etc., which I'll be continuing in my succeeding class, in the next class. Thank you very much for watching this video.